Welcome back to the Florida Parish of Sportsmen, Wayne Glascock. Segment number two of the Great American Loop Adventure, Great American Circle Loop Adventure, whatever you choose to call it. It is the circumnavigation of the eastern coast of the United States. You saw in version one where we left here in, actually didn't leave in Hammond. We left from our camp on the Amite River, 10 Point, went through Wrigley's Pass, spent the night Ship Island to Destin, and you know, as we were in Destin with my entire family doing the 4th of July, it rained and rained and rained. So we left there early. We picked up two stragglers, two actually very, very, very talented people, a lawyer and his girlfriend from Arkansas. And they jumped on the boat with us in Destin, you probably remember this, and took the ride with us from there. Well, they were going to go to Fort Myers, rent a car, and come back. Actually, we went to Fort Myers. We crossed Florida, went to the other side and all the way up to St. Augustine. So they were on the boat with us for almost 3 weeks, which it was three of the best weeks of this trip. We had a great time there, great people, and just, you know, we Southerners speak a language like no other, but we understand each other, especially the, all of us in the SEC or that are football lovers or athletic lovers, and we had a blast with these guys. But I always felt a certain kinship with the Arkansas people, just because looking at them, kind of like looking in the mirror, we're all that Scots-Irish, migration from way back when, so you know we're all very similar in backgrounds. But when we get to, and we, like I say, they took the trip with us all the way to St. Augustine. As we left segment number one, we actually didn't take it all the way to St. Augustine. We ended in what was basically the Mosquito Lagoon. We're showing the manatees. First time we really got into a whole lot of manatees, where the manatees are, you know, completely surrounding the boat, and that's kind of the way we left the show. And we're going to start this show now, going from the Mosquito Lagoon back up to St. Augustine. Now, St. Augustine, a great city. But first, I got to tell you this, my wife asked me not to do this today, but I'm going to do it anyway because I want to tell you exactly the way what happened on this trip. And I alluded in the first segment that everything on the ship was absolutely perfect, and 99.9% of all the people we met were just great people, and couldn't have been any nicer. But, you know, there's always one or two here. So we're going through this area, and this area in Florida, I mean, I'm not going to say the city because I don't know if the statute of limitations has run out of what I did up there. So, anyhow, we're coming through this, and look, we're talking about $2, 3, and $5 million homes on 100-foot and 150-foot lots for not just a little ways, not a subdivision, not a development, but for like 15 miles, 10 miles at least. So you got 10 miles of... A multi-million dollar home stacked side by side by side, and then you're on an intercoastal waterway. So you can imagine what's out on the beach. If these are multi-million dollar homes, you can imagine the same thing out on the beach, facing the beach. But this was on the intercoastal waterway. But anyhow, we're cruising along, and here I am with our flag. Well, we had just met this couple, or passed a boat with a couple in it, and he, you know, we yak back and forth about Florida Gators, chomp chomp, or whatever it was, and you know, we had our LSU flag. Now, I knew that I was taking a risk flying this flag through five SEC, you know, hostile territory, but it was worth the risk for me, and I was willing to take a little ribbon and stuff, so, and had prepared to do so, and did so. But we get through this thing, and we're just cruising along, Judy and I, my wife and I, just cruising along easily, and all of a sudden, this gentleman from way up on the hill, had steps coming down, starts screaming at the top of his voice at me. And I mean, comes down the first landing and shaking his fist, and I couldn't hear him, the boat's running, you know, and had the radio going. But I could see his gesture, and I could see his very, very aggressive nature. And, you know, I could really kind of ignore it. I figured it was something to do with our flag, you know. So I was going, I wasn't even going to pay any attention to it. Well, here comes his wife, much younger, probably a second or third wife, out of a, you know, $5 or $6 million home. Here she comes with a white poodle. The poodle's following them down to the landing, and all three of them are shaking their fingers at me and screaming at the top of their voices. So, you know, I really didn't know what to do, so it kept cruising along. But the further they got down, as these tiers went down to the terraces down to the water, got closer to me. Well, he got to the bottom thing and said, "You moron!" And I kind of known for having a hair trigger and no off button, but when I tell you I went off on this guy, it was like something took control of me. I throw the boat in neutral, put it in reverse, and start backing down toward him. And he was speaking, you know, very vulgar language. Well, heck, I'm from South Louisiana. I speak that language. I probably speak it better than he speaks it. Anyhow, I was going to give him some language lessons, and I'm backing down on him the whole time. Well, it went from rage in this guy's face to ultimate fear. I mean, you could see it. I could see it from the boat. He went from screaming to like, oh my gosh, and you could see the wife, and it got so bad, she was holding her hands over her ears. And it got even worse than that, she was holding her hands over the dog's ears. But anyway, I'm backing down on this guy, and I'm fixing to jump out the boat in his front yard. And when I tell you, they turned tail and ran up the stairs into the house. And I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but and my wife is looking at me. She said, Wayne, Glascock, what is wrong with you? I said, well, that was a little, he called me a moron. All over me flying this flag. She said, he wasn't mad at you about the flag. He was mad at you about your wake. I said, oh, God, wake flag. You know, I'm pretty proud of that wake, too. So, you know, some things you could, I'd probably take it back. I probably wouldn't take it back if I could. But some things you can't take back, and this is one of the things that can't take back. But that's really one person out of tens of thousands that we've met and or at least had interaction with along this trip that really gave me grief. And I tell you, his wake enforcing skills probably have diminished some, because you never know what you're going to get when you attack somebody, especially as aggressively as he attacked us verbally. You never know what you're going to get. But I bet you he never does it to anybody flying a 5x7 LSU flag again.
There's magic in my eyes. I can see for miles and miles and miles and miles and miles. Oh yeah. If you think that I don't know about the little tricks you play and never see you of other guys, and now you've got the nerve to say that you still want me. Well, that says maybe, but you gotta stand trial, because all the while I can see for miles and miles. I can see for miles and miles. I can see for miles. Thank you.
All right, back to a more positive note. We left in Mosquito Lagoon. You saw the manatees and stuff. And going north from there on the intercoastals, one of my favorite areas, called the Palm Coast or Space Coast, because you stay on the inside, Cape Canaveral, kind of out as a cape into the ocean. And, you know, of course, it's where all the launches come that used to do the space shuttle, but that is discontinued. They still have launches maybe twice a month or something like that, and it's really something to see. So anyhow, we would take the intercoastal going north from the Space Coast, from the Palm Coast, and we go into St. Augustine. Well, there's not a whole bunch of stuff to do in St. I mean, there's a lot of things to do in St. Augustine. There's not much that we did in St. Augustine. Went out to eat a couple of nights and actually went through one of tens of thousands of forts. It seems like maybe, you know, 10 or 20 forts that we visited on this trip, because every place you go with a boat and you come in through that harbor, they basically were all at one time protected by a fort, by either the Spanish, the English, the Americans, the British, whomever was manning those, the French at the time, and claiming it as their property. Well, this was settled by Ponce de Leon, and St. Augustine is the oldest settlement. It predates Jamestown by some 60 or 80 years, the oldest city in the state. And he would look into, of course, Ponce de Leon for the Fountain of Youth, and not sure whether he found it or not, but it is certainly a great city to enter. When we ran offshore, go up to a real nice marina. I don't remember the name of the marina, but really, really nice marina. And stayed there, wanted to get some oil changed and stuff. And of course, Robert and Lisa were leaving. They rented a car, headed back to Destin to get in their car to head back to Arkansas, which they've been sitting in the parking lot there, boating their car and trailer and their boat in a boat slip. And in Destin, Florida, and I had prepaid that boat slip for mine for a month, so I think I let somebody use it or whatever we did with it. But anyhow, their boat was still in that slip. And Judy and I rented a car to come back home. Well, of course, come back, do our business, whatever we had to do. And on our way back, our son Andrew goes with us. Well, he likes that. You know, there's a lot of military stuff going over there. Andrew's a pilot, and he loves all of the military stuff, especially military planes. And there's just constant planes in and out on that side of the ocean, or on that side of the coast, the East Coast. Lots of military installations. So anyhow, when we get back to St. Augustine, and then we load the boat up, they'd change the oils or whatever we were doing there, and did a great job. Camachi Cove is the name of the marina, and look, I highly recommend it. Really, really, really nice place. Now we leave there, and of course we jump back off the inlet there at St. Augustine, and start heading north. And look, we get up and running. We're doing 22, 23 knots, and 23 or 24 miles an hour, I should say. And staying offshore and getting a pretty good little chop and ride. And then when we get just north of Jacksonville, we're looking at this thing. And I'm sorry that we don't have a whole bunch of video to show you. And it was a little tumultuous time. It was a little bit rough, but we run into this ocean of military vessels. They were, you know, military painted, and of course Coast Guard, white with the orange stripe. Lots of Coast Guard stuff, but lots of military. And this boat that was going between, it looked like two boats to us. We said, gosh, that boat's sure following that one pretty closely, right in front of us. And come to find out, it was a nuclear submarine. First time anywhere I've ever seen one. Of course, they're pretty secretive about these things. But here it is, and they got all these support vessels blocking us. Well, no one really called us on the radio or said anything, and we're up and running, headed straight toward this nuclear submarine. They went up and I said, but God, that's a strange looking boat, and another boat right on its tail. Well, what it was the periscope area, the top area of the submarine, and the tail both sticking out. Well, they were both making wakes, this making a big wake, which looked like a boat running, and the tail back behind sticking out, and it looked like another boat, looked like two boats running. Well, Andrew figured it out, and of course he gets out his cell phone and says, oh my God, there's the Wolfpack base for this Triton's whatever class of nuclear submarine is just off the coast here, just north of Jacksonville in Georgia or wherever. And we're up running now. So anyhow, we kind of stopped and let all of this pass through. But as we're going into, or headed to our South Carolina, we stopped at Hilton Head, South Carolina. Now, and the reason this really kind of means something to me, in a former life when I was working for Mr. Despain, we bought an airplane in Torino, Italy, and flew that airplane back, rounded the horn, Newfoundland, back down to Buffalo, New York, had it refitted, flew it into Baton Rouge. And there is a marina on Hilton Head, where all of the golf courses are, right there at the country club, that is an identical replica of a downtown marina in Torino, Italy. And the gentleman that developed this, or the gentlemen, or the ladies and gentlemen, whomever developed this place, went there, saw that it was such a nice place, and came back and replicated it on Hilton Head. And we spent the night there, which is, you know, it's kind of hard to get a slip because it's a private club, but, you know, tipping gets you pretty much anywhere on this trip if you're willing to do it. But we went to and spent the night there. Matter of fact, I think we spent a couple of nights there. Real nice restaurants, great. South Carolina, that part of South Carolina is a real nice place over there. But anyhow, we spent the night in this at Hilton Head in this identical replica of a marina in Torino, Italy. Left there the next day, headed to and arrived in South Carolina. There's this cut you go through. We call them cut coupes down here, whatever, Trenos, but it was a dredged canal channel from from the intercoastal with very, very, very swift current. It was a 6 or 8 mile an hour current, one of the swiftest that we had seen on the trip that you go through. And it's an alternate route. You can really go around, go through the Ashley River and come in, or go the other direction. I don't remember this, but anyhow, this, and we came to this little cove, very, very, very swift current, which, and I'm glad I did, because it was our first real taste of current. And the Ashley River and Charleston, South Carolina have a lot of current. So we pulled into, they got this dock there called the Mega Dock. It's the city-owned marina in Charleston. And we wanted to stay there and actually pulled up there, but it was really swift. We were exposed, we were below the bridge, and we were exposed to a lot of boat traffic there. And looking at my charts and stuff, I don't own a chart, looking at my iPad and seeing that there's another really nice marina up closer to the bridge with less traffic and a little less, well, current. And, basically the same thing the mega dock goes through. It's called Ashley Marina, really nice marina, real nice clubhouse. And you know, they had restaurants and they had a courtesy car. They actually had a driver that would drive you anywhere you wanted to go. So we decided to move on up to the Ashley Marina, and that's where we stayed. So we docked the boat. Andrew and I went around. We actually went to a, there's a battleship, no, a flat top of aircraft carrier. And we spent an entire day on the aircraft carrier there in Charleston. Ate at some of the great restaurants. They do have some great restaurants in downtown Charleston. We did all of the Charleston area. And of course, he had to come back and go to work. We got to film shows here. So Andrew, we were in a car. Oh, put him on an airplane. And he flew back. Well, Judy and I stayed. And I guess maybe 3 or 4 days later, 4 or 5 days later, we were actually in Charleston for a month. Maybe a week later, my daughter and grandson fly in. Well, Carly wanted to, my daughter wanted to do the shopping area and the restaurant things and all of the things that Charleston had to offer. And that's pretty much what we did. She was there for almost a week, and we really did Charleston up. Went through all the museums with our grandson. Went back to the boats, went to the Maritime Museum, went to the Space Museum, and I say a Space Museum, whatever the museums of the du jour were, the Charleston Museum certainly, and others. We spent a week there doing that. And it's a great city. It really is a great city. And we stayed there for a week. Or she did with us for a week, but we actually stayed there for a month. And we rented a car, came back home for 4 or 5 days, turned around and went back. And I hope you're enjoying these things. Paul is spending a lot of time doing editing, and a lot of this scenery that you see, not voiceover, because it lots of times either Judy running the camera, or I was running the boat, or I was running the camera, so there wasn't a whole lot of voice. And that's the reason I'm doing a whole lot of voice here in the studio, which is something we don't normally do. We usually do it mic'd outside. It's still unscripted. It's still straight off the cuff. It's just as every show. This is our 20th year, 20 years of doing this Bill Hood Florida Parish Sportsman Show, and we've never scripted one word. I've never read a teleprompter from one segment, anything that we've ever done. It's all off the cuff. And hopefully you like it that way, because that's just the way it happens, and we're going to tell it to you just the way it happened. But stay with us on the Florida Parish Sportsman. There's some really good things on this trip coming. I promise you, you'll enjoy some of this stuff. We're in South Carolina, fixing to leave Charleston on our next segment. We'll leave Charleston and go. I'm not sure what the time gives us, but we're going to go up the East Coast and keep you up to date with what the boat's doing. We're looking, looks now like it's going to be at least 6 shows. This is show number 2 in a series of 6. Paul is, he's been on 2 major full-length movies, one that he actually did as his own movie, or maybe 1 or 2 of them. And horror movies, I think I told him the other day that I did this little treatment, trying to get, I'm a redneck, got these sun marks all over my face. That I could have starred in one of his horror movies about 2 weeks ago, so we're running a little bit behind, him in the movie business and me in the horror movie. Could have shot a scene in one of those by the way my face looked, but it's getting a little better, we're getting ready to move on to segment number 3. But in the meantime, stay with us on Bill Hood Florida Parish Sportsman. We've been doing this for 20 years. Obviously, you like it. We are now, I tell you in the last segment, we're up to about half the population state. We are actually, with our new footprint, with the Baton Rouge and New Orleans DMA, Nielsen DMAs for AT&T, and we're on both of those DMAs now with our PEC channel, that we are playing to, by their numbers, 55.23% of the population of Louisiana. And I don't really know of a broadcast station except with cable access or internet access that's doing that. And of course, we're worldwide with our online. You can watch us online anywhere in the world that's got a cell signal or a Wi-Fi. But hardlined from one of the four major carriers. It's got ETEL, AT&T, Charter, and Cox. That covers basically all of South Louisiana. Online as well. Then, you know, we pretty much got this blanketed. But 55.23% of the population watching our show. And I hope at least some of those new viewers enjoy watching this show, even 1/100th as much as we enjoy bringing it to you. Just stay with us here on the Florida Parish of Sportsman, the Bill Hood Florida Parish of Sportsman.
Rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me. So rock me, mama, like a wind in the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, mama, rock me. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me. Thank you.